South American Indian culture starts with Caral, which is about 120 kilometers north of Lima in the Supe River Valley. This is where the Indians first started building large stone structures, and they started that in 2600 BC. It has all of the basic formula that you'll find all the way through the Mayan and Aztec cultures, with amphitheaters, large courtyards, and pyramids. The interesting thing about 2600 BC, of course, is that that's approximately the same time that the Egyptians were building the Great Pyramid. So there's not a great deal of difference in terms of time between the progress in South America with the Indians and with the European and Middle Eastern cultures. To get to the Maya, we really have to jump ahead about 4,000 years. Now, this is going to be a certain amount of boring history, but please stick with me. At around 1200 AD, Manco Capac, the first Inca, came up from the Lake Titicaca area and settled in Cuzco. And Cuzco was the home of the Inca and the center of their power. They were just another mountain tribe up until about 1430. Now in 1430, what happens is one of their neighbors start pressing them. And their neighbors are doing so well against the Inca that the Inca king and the crown prince basically quit the field and are ready to retreat from Cuzco. However, one of the younger brothers was named Pachacuti. And Pachacuti takes command of the tribe of the Incas, and he defeats his enemies, and he starts a campaign putting together a huge empire. In fact, Pachacuti is in many ways very much like Napoleon. Virtually everything that the Inca were said to have done and done well, Pachacuti was said to have started. Well, Pachacuti now is followed then by a series of fairly good Inca kings. And now these kings extended the empire, and they extended the empire right up until the time that the Spanish arrived. When the Spanish arrived, Atahualpa was the Inca. Now, the Inca Empire at that time, by some measures, was the largest empire in the world. If it had started in New York City, for example, it would have stretched all the way down to Panama, because it was from Ecuador, almost Colombia really, all the way down to Santiago, Chile, and included even parts of Argentina. Now, Atahualpa's father had been Inca, and he had the army in the north conquering Ecuador, and he was centered up in Quitos, and he had married a local Quitos princess, and that was Atahualpa's mother. He also had another son, Huascar, down in Cuzco, and the old man was fond of Atahualpa and wanted Atahualpa to succeed him in some way, although Huascar was probably the more legitimate heir to the throne. So his father decided to split the empire, the north going to Atahualpa at the old man's death, and the south going to Huascar at Cuzco. When the old man died, probably of smallpox, civil war broke out between the two sons. But Atahualpa had the advantage because he had the battle-tested veteran Inca army under his control. You know the rest of the story. Atahualpa visits Pizarro, who has only about 200 Spaniards under his control. Pizarro seizes Atahualpa and demands gold, and the Inca king delivers one room full of gold and two of silver. Atahualpa delivers the gold, and in so doing, the Spanish send some envoys to Cuzco to supervise the collection of the gold there, and the envoys returned from Cuzco. This is a modern map of Cuzco, but the old city of Cuzco is the area outlined in the blue ink. You'll notice that it forms the shape of a cougar, and that's no accident. The city of Cuzco is built on Inca foundations, and you can see that in many of the old streets, especially in the center of town. This particular one is just off the main plaza. What has happened, of course, is that after the Spanish took control of Cuzco, they leveled basically all of the Inca palaces and temples, and they converted them to either the uses for the Catholic Church or for the Spanish administration or for housing for nobles. This is the Plaza de Armas, the major town square in Cuzco, and in Inca times this square was actually twice the size that it is now. The churches that you see were originally Inca palaces. And incidentally, there's a little demonstration going on there in the background. You see those people in white? That's some kind of little political demonstration. Something else that you'll notice here is that many of the buildings surrounding the square have arched porticos of one kind or another, and they have balconies. And you can see those balconies and porticos in the 16th and 17th century woodcuts of Cuzco, so those are quite original. Well, back to Atahualpa. When he was a captive of the Spanish and he delivered the gold, he expected Pizarro, of course, would let him go, but Pizarro did not. The next thing that Atahualpa does is kind of interesting. He sends messages to his generals in Cuzco to kill his brother Huascar, who is now his captive, and that's done. Shortly thereafter, the Spanish ask whether or not Atahualpa would become a Christian. Atahualpa was shown a Bible and told that it was the Word of God, and so he picked up the Bible and he put it to his ear. But when he heard nothing, he threw it on the ground. Now, that was an action that was not well calculated to improve his relationship with the Spanish, unfortunately. Atahualpa was told that he was going to be killed, and they asked him whether he would prefer to be burned as a heathen or strangled to death as a Christian. Now, this is an important decision for Atahualpa because the Inca did believe that the body had to be maintained intact in order to get the full benefit out of your afterlife, much like the Egyptians. The result of that is that he decided that he would become a Christian so that he could be strangled to death and his body be preserved. Incidentally, something that I've noticed about both Cuzco and Lima, for that matter, is that both of them are very lively places 24 hours a day. There always seems to be something going on. Commerce is going on, frequently there's music, parties, and you would imagine that this was driven almost entirely by tourists, but it's my impression that that's simply not true. Of course, tourists do provide a large amount of backbone to the economy, especially in Cuzco, but the local people seem to be every bit as interested in partying all night as the tourists are. But in Cuzco, of course, tourists are the major source of revenue.
Welcome to Cuzco. Would you like to buy a CD?
Welcome to Cuzco. You like Cuzco?
Welcome to Cuzco. Welcome to Peru. I am Marlene. I sell the dolls and puppets. All is my work. Bye.
This is a model of the Coricancha, the temple to the sun that the Incas had before the Spanish came in and changed the architecture. The major source, or a major source at least, of the gold that Atahualpa gave to Pizarro almost certainly came from this temple. This temple is said to have been absolutely covered with plate gold. And the envoys that Pizarro sent to Cusco reported that this place was just loaded with gold. This is the actual stonework that remains of the Coricancha. In Incan society, gold was not used in commerce. It was used solely for religious purposes, and gold was supposed to be the metal of the sun. The moon, on the other hand, was represented by silver. Incidentally, silver and gold traditionally in the old world had the same value up until this period. There was so much silver found in the Americas that it permanently changed the balance of the price between gold and silver. It is said that this temple was covered by 700 solid gold plates, each one weighing about 5 pounds. And as you can see, the stonework here is absolutely superb. The stones fit as closely together as any that were created anywhere, I believe, in the world, probably. The fountain that is in the middle of the courtyard is the original Inca fountain, and it was said to have had 55 kilos, that's well over 100 pounds, of gold on it. On the opposite side of the courtyard is the Temple to the Moon, and we would assume that it was probably plated in solid silver. If you take a close look at the wall, you can see some small holes in these stones, and they may have had pegs in them. Those pegs may have allowed the solid silver to be mounted on the wall. I didn't see any on the Sun Temple for mounting gold, however. One of the things that's on the temple, though, is you can see little holes that have been filled with wood, and my guess is that the wood that's up there is the original roofing material. In addition to the solid gold and silver plates, there would have been a large number of precious metal objects. One of them would have been the solar disk, which has been depicted here in a park in Cusco, but the original solar disk probably did look something like this. Meanwhile, back at the Coricancha, there are Inca reenactors. The old man that you're about to see who's playing the priest is actually a teacher, and the girls are playing the parts of the Virgins of the Sun. The language you just heard was Quechua, which is the language of the Inca, and it's the language spoken by a fairly large number of the rural people. Spanish is, of course, spoken in the major metropolitan areas and in Cusco. But we happen to be now at Sacsayhuaman. Now, there's always been a dispute as to just exactly what this was. But as you can see, it was a very large stone structure. And if you remember that map that I showed you of Cusco, this is the head of the cougar, the head of the puma. And some people say that this was a temple, but the Spanish referred to it as a fortress. And with stones like this, in three jagged rows, My gosh, it must have functioned very much like a fortress. In addition, Sacsayhuaman had at least three large towers, stone towers, on the top of it. Now, those towers now are completely gone, but when the Spanish were here, this must have been a really big complex. It's said to have been built by Pachacuti. He started in about 1430, and it was said to have been finished around 1508. The Spanish arrived in the 1530s, so this was a new building when the Spanish arrived. Well, we're at Sacsayhuaman now. The guides, when they talk about this place, will always tell you that it's Sacsayhuaman. They tell you that so that you can remember the name. Now, the Spanish, they thought that this location was a fortress. And indeed, it's built very much like a fortress. But Garcilio de la Vega, El Inca, said it was really just a temple, but it has a lot of massive stonework in it. Now, Garcia Lasco was a very interesting person all by himself. He was the son of a conquistador captain and also of an Inca princess. And the result is that he probably had access to about as much information about the conquest and the Incas as anybody did. So his opinions are probably pretty good. Shortly after the Spanish killed the Inca Aluapa, they occupied Cuzco and they made it their capital. Cuzco had, of course, been the capital of the Incas. But it wasn't long after that they had installed a puppet Inca by the name of Manco. And Manco got tired of being a puppet. And so eventually what happens is that there's an Inca revolt. Actually, there are several Inca revolts, but this is probably the most important one, certainly the first one. The Spanish numbered only about 200. They were bottled up in the city of Cuzco. The Inca, it's difficult to say how many there were. At their height, the Inca Empire could muster maybe 200,000 warriors, but after all the European diseases had run through the country and they had already been defeated once, and there had been a civil war, it's difficult to say how many warriors there were, but there must have been a very large number of them. Certainly there were thousands of them up here at Sacsayhuaman. Now, the Spanish decided that the only way that they could break the siege was to take this citadel-like location. They had about 70 or 80 horses with them, and the Inca were terrified of horses. And so they mounted everybody that they possibly could on a horse, and they sent their cavalry force charging up here to Sacsayhuaman. It must have been a tremendous battle, because we know that something like 1,500 Inca warriors were killed here by the Spanish. At one of the towers, there was an Inca noble who was fighting using a Spanish sword and Spanish shield, and he was fairly successful in fending off the Spanish until he was overwhelmed. But eventually, the Spanish did take this location, although at some cost. For example, Juan Pizarro was killed in the attack. The symbol of the city of Cuzco is the condor, which devoured the dead Inca warriors. I found these two condors just outside the Department of Justice. I'm sure there must be some relationship. These rocks are absolutely huge. The one that you're about ready to see here in a minute is said to weigh 125 tons. The Spanish had the Inca cart away as many of these stones as they could into Cuzco. But Garcia Lasco de la Vega, El Inca, says that the Inca did not know how to move the largest stones. If the construction was started only a century before the Spanish arrived, how could the Inca have forgotten how to move those giant stones? And I think that the answer is very interesting. The answer is almost certainly that Garcia Lasco de la Vega was correct. The Inca didn't move those stones. In fact, the Inca were not the first people at this particular site. In Cuzco, you can see some evidence of pre-Inca foundation stones. Here is the back of the Coricancha. This is where the solar observatory is. If you look just below that, down into the courtyard, you will see eventually a wall, and that wall is pre-Inca. It's the light green stones that you're going to be seeing in just a few seconds. It's those pre-Inca builders who may have had the knowledge and the ability to move those large stones. And perhaps the Inca settled in Cuzco not so much because the soil was good, but because there had been occupation there already and that there were already large stone buildings in the area. When the Spanish broke the siege at Cuzco, Manco moved his capital, the Inca capital, to this location, Ollantaytambo. Ollantaytambo is not very far from Cuzco, and as you can see, it is a very, very steep hill. And the Inca put their fortifications, their soldiers, their warriors, up on that hill and on those terraces. And there must have been thousands upon thousands of them. And the Spanish attacked them. There were only about 200 Spanish, as you'll recall, and of course their Indian allies. But the Spanish made the cutting edge of that army. But this was the first time, the only real time, the Inca turned back the Spanish at Ollantaytambo. The conquistadors were then reinforced by Spanish troops that had been down in Chile occupying that area. And with those reinforcements, Manco was forced to retire from Ollantaytambo, and he went to Vilcabamba, which is deeper in the jungle. Vilcabamba was the last capital of the Incas. The Spanish located it, and eventually they defeated the Inca rebellion. But the location of the Vilcabamba was lost. And that brings us to 1911 and Hiram Bingham, who was searching for the Vilcabamba, and he happened to stumble on to Machu Picchu. Unlike Hiram Bingham, we're going to be going to Machu Picchu by train. Curiously enough, this train line was laid down and designed in 1908, several years before Machu Picchu was discovered. Machu Picchu. Machu Picchu had been lost to the Spaniards. It had been occupied during Inca times up until about the time that the Spanish came in. Now, Machu Picchu had been lost for
for as far as the civilized world was concerned up until 1911. Then Hiram Bingham, who was out here looking for Vilcabamba, happened to stumble across it and think it was Vilcabamba. Vilcabamba was the last capital city of the Incas. The Spanish knew about that. They had attacked Vilcabamba and taken it. But then they had lost track of where Vilcabamba was located. Hiram Bingham started looking for it. Now, when he found Machu Picchu, at first he thought it was Vilcabamba, the last capital city of the Incas. But there were a couple of other explanations for Machu Picchu as well. First of all, it's very small. So there was some thought that it might be the first city rather than the last city of the Incas. Although we're fairly sure it wasn't the first city, because after all, Cuzco was, according to their legends, the first city of the Incas. There was a third possibility, and that was that it could possibly have been the place where the women that were dedicated to the sun god, the virgins of the sun, stayed. And when Hiram Bingham came back in 1912, he brought with him an anthropologist, and the anthropologist examined some bodies that were found here. There were a number of them, about 100, and he determined that 80% of those were women. Now, based on that, it was thought that this might possibly be the location of the Virgins of the Sun. However, just a few years ago, those bones were re-examined. And anthropologists now believe that 80% was not the correct figure. It was roughly 50-50. And some of the women had given birth. So it's unlikely that this was the location of the Virgins of the Sun. So the question is, what is Machu Picchu?
Machu Picchu is generally described as being divided between an urban sector, which you see here, where the buildings are, and an agricultural sector, that is, where these terraces are located. The problem with Machu Picchu as a city is that those residences appear to be capable of housing roughly 300 people. On the other hand, if you take a look at the terraces, many of which are in the urban area, not in the agricultural area as it was defined, those terraces are only capable of feeding a few dozen people, not much more. Certainly not the 300 that could be housed here. So on any kind of regular basis, when the city was full of people, food and probably other substances as well would have had to have been brought into the city from very, very far away. And those terraces are a very complex construction. They're built out of stone, of course, on the face, but it's the inside of the terrace that's really most interesting. There's coarse gravel down at the bottom with finer gravel as you go up near the top. And finally, it's topped off with topsoil. And that topsoil, at least, had to be carried up all the way from the river below, about 1,000 feet below this particular point. Now, why go to all this trouble for those terraces? Well, the Inca knew that this area, in fact, virtually all of the core Inca area, gets very heavy rainfall, some 90 inches per year. The result of that is that the soil has a strong tendency to wash away just about everywhere, and that would be especially true here at Machu Picchu. In this particular case, those terraces are important not just for agricultural purposes, but like claws, they tend to anchor the city onto the mountain. If it hadn't been for those terraces, engineers say that these buildings, almost all of them, would be down on the river floor by now. Some 60% of the Inca work at Machu Picchu is actually underground, and much of it has to do with hydrology, driving the water away from the buildings and protecting the buildings from erosion. One of the memorable things about Machu Picchu is that it has about 100 flights of stairs, and I think frankly that I have climbed just about every one of them that's there. Notice that the Inca almost always used the post and lintel door construction system, the large stone at the top going across both sides of the door. This happens to be the high rent district in Machu Picchu. This is probably where noble people lived, or perhaps even Inca princesses. Now what we're focusing on next is going to be the route up to Machu Picchu that you take today. Down in the valley floor is where the train stops, and from the train normally you will pick up a bus. Now it is possible to hike up to the top, but most people take the bus, and the bus takes that little switchback road. You can see that little white line in the on the mountain. It goes back and forth and back and forth, and that's how the bus gets up to Machu Picchu. But Bingham didn't come up that way. Instead, he came up the other side of the mountain, starting from that river valley down there, where he found a farmer that told him that there was something up here. And the farmer's 12-year-old boy led him up this steep cliff right here, all the way up to the top. And that's the first time that he saw any of the ruins at Machu Picchu. This next building should remind you of the back of the Coracancha, because like the back of the Coracancha, this is a solar observatory for discovering when the solstice occurs. Underneath it, there's sort of a little artificial cave, and inside there is a sacrificial table. We were told that it was usually used for sacrificing llamas, although there is some indication that human sacrifice was carried on with the Incas, although not with the frequency as with the Aztecs. The solar observatory has the odd shape that it does in order to get the sun's shadow to reflect in the right way to allow them to predict the solstices. And that's why it's not perfectly round. In back, those little niches were used for storage, somewhat like closets.
Again, using the wooden door, then a tree trunk in an horizontal shape in here that they tied with a rope, and they pass through these holes. All right, another tree trunk is standing up, and it was tied to the ring stone that we can see on the top of the lintel.
Heck of a lot.
That I told you, only two doorways in Machu Picchu have these carvings. The rest of the doorways don't.
Notice that the doorways tend to lean in. In fact, all of the walls in the Inca buildings tend to lean in, and that's part of a design. It's to help earthquake-proof the building. In addition, when they build, they frequently don't use regular stones. They make irregular stones fit into the wall, and that once again gives the wall more stability than it would have if the stones were dressed exactly the way the Romans or the Greeks or somebody else might have done them, in perfectly regular rows. This is the famous hitching post of the sun, or sometimes it's referred to as a sundial, although frankly it doesn't tell the time of day, but rather the time of year.
And it's up here where Incas carved this stone, still for astronomical purposes. This is the stone that is very well known as the sundial. And the Incas again projected shadows
using the corners and the angles of this stone. But we can see that the stone also has four corners, that each one again is pointing to the four directions of the world. North, west, south, and east. East. And this small one, that it was the one that was making a perfect shadow line in 21st of June, you know, to this another angle. And from here, the sunlight, we're getting to this rock. See? That was carved also by the Incas. Look at it. Looks like the a guinea pig head. Who was asking for the guinea pig? Well, for the researchers that found these shadows, this is a puma shape, a puma head. And right in here we can see the eye that was carved also in the stone. So it's in this side that the Incas projected perfectly the north triangle constellation with the sun lights that they could see only every 21st of June. But the question is, how did the Incas know about the North Triangle constellation, because it's a constellation that we don't see in South America? So they knew also constellations that we don't see in this continent. That's why these steps that were made in here, for the astronomer that would watch or observe these shadows, right? Because these steps are not to get to the terracings. We'll find other steps that are getting to the terracings. This one, it was for this reason. But I said that this stone was. Why in past tense? Because 3 years ago, a VR company came to Machu Picchu to film a commercial. And they put, standed up in here, a bottle of beer, you know, and with the big equipment that they were filming, they crashed the top of the. Look at that. Exactly the one, one that is making the shadow line and projected over there, not the shadows. It's ruined, no, it's ruined, because the rest of the stones were not fit anymore. They are not going to fit anymore of the fountains. Or ceremonial baths are being made. But actually these were not baths to take a shower or to take a bath, these were fountains. Because the same water is flowing through all of them and going lower. What would happen if somebody would take a shower up here? The water would flow totally there. So these were fountains where Incas had to get the water in containers, you know, for washing, cooking, cleaning up, etc. But look at what a beautiful work it is made, you know, when they carved this channel. And look at it here.
As I said earlier, a lot of the construction at Machu Picchu has to do with hydrology. The fountain system that happens to be here is a major piece of work for as far as the Inca are concerned. Although not quite up to Roman standards, this is quite an impressive piece of aqueduct. It was sufficiently impressive that I started tracing back the water because I wanted to see where that water came from. And we're going to trace it back. We're going to walk back along the terraces and along where the fountains are until we locate the source of the water. And the source of the water that I discovered was something of a surprise to the guide. Because I told the guide that I traced the water all the way back to a corrugated metal pipe. The fact of the matter is that water is supposed to have been coming through an Inca channel, and that's what the guide had thought. But in fact, the water at Machu Picchu doesn't come from the original source, at least not directly. One of the things that you've probably noticed is that a number of the houses at Machu Picchu would look almost perfect if they had their thatch roofs on, and you might have wondered how those were attached. That little stone up there with the hole in it is the way that the roof was attached to the stonework. And you can see that on this particular house, on each side of where the roof should be, there are a couple of those little stone eyes. And in addition to that, you can also see what appears to be a cylindrical stone that's used to lash the thatch roof on. And that cylindrical stone kind of looks like it probably is representing some kind of a log. In any event, that's the way that those thatched roofs are put on. Now, the guide told me that those thatched roofs actually only lasted about a year. And every year that grass had to be changed out. And then I told the guide that in Europe, thatched roofs may last about a century. And the difference is that in Europe, they use water plants for the thatching, and here they were using simple grass. In the next scene, we see the underside of a thatched roof, and you'll be seeing how that roof is constructed, how the poles are arranged, and how they are lashed together. Next, we're going to be taking a short walk away from Machu Picchu, down one of the old Inca trails, or more correctly, up one of the old Inca trails. And what we're going to be looking for is an Inca bridge. Now, this is basically a stone bridge that has a wooden drawbridge on it. But I'm panning down from the top of the mountain because I want to show you how sheer the cliff is that that bridge is located on. And I want you to remember, when we get down to the bridge, that you're not nearly at the bottom of the mountain. There's still 1,000 feet to go or more before you get down to the river below. You can see the bridge now. It's that stonework in the center of the picture. And the wooden slats that are referred to as the drawbridge are up at the top.
In here, this professor tried to explain how Incas cut the stones. And what they explained, you know, is the same technique that as Egyptians made. Following the natural fissures, these professors employed harder stones. They made holes along the fissure, then they fitted wood. They watered the wood expanded, and then the rock split. So this is an experiment that worked because the rock was broken. Look at here, half of these carvings. And this is the half of this rock. But there is an exception in the case of the Incas.
There's no holes there.
Exactly. You know, in all quarries that we can see in Cuzco, we don't find these remains. Somebody was saying, oh, that's probably why Incas carved around the corners. Yeah, this is understandable for the ones that they used for their buildings, but why they should smooth the stones that they wouldn't use anymore and they left in the quarries. Like in this stone, look, this is a clear example. See this? Incas also took pieces from here, all the smooth, here another piece. So there were, so later there were theories also of other researchers that were saying that Incas melted the stones with some herbs, you know, wild herbs probably that is growing in these mountains. But the herbs were not found. So this is not possible. There is nothing that can melt the stones.
Yeah. Right.
But still many speculations and theories because there was not a writing, you know, of how Incas cut the stones, built the...
So, now we're back to our original question. What is Machu Picchu? What is the purpose for Machu Picchu? Well, anthropologists, archaeologists, all argued about this for a very long time. It turns out, however, that the lawyers knew the answer. Yes, that's right. You see, shortly after the Spanish took control of this area, still back in the 16th century, there was a court case in Cuzco. And in that court case, descendants of Pachacuti were suing some other natives that were up here in these ruins. And they're suing for the ownership of the land. And it was those descendants that proved that this place was owned by Pachacuti. And you can tell that from the court records. Well, so what was it used for? This was basically Camp David. This is where the Inca came in order to relax. This was his winter residence, because although Cuzco is at 11,000 feet, Machu Picchu is only at 8,000 feet, and it's a little bit warmer here.
All kinds of people come to Machu Picchu for all kinds of reasons, and some of those reasons are kind of different, at least from my perspective. The guide is about ready to tell us a story. It's a story that I had never heard before, and it's a story that you'll have to listen closely to, because even I wasn't paying very much attention to this story when it started.
Story on the site we came, but all this around there of a Californian man that came to Machu Picchu with a spiritual group to make some spiritual things. And when they were going up in the opposite way, he came. He was the last one on the line, and he started to hear the voice of a spirit that was telling him or saying him, jump. And he jumped. He jumped, and it was 150 feet down, but he felt nothing happened. And he still kept listening to the voice. Jump again, and he responded to the spirit, no, I'm scared. Trust me, the spirit told him. So he jumped another 150 feet down. It's a true story.
How would they know?
It was in 1997. So for third time, again nothing happened. For third time the spirit told him jump. And this man said, no, I'm afraid. Trust me. And he jumped again for third time. And when he was flying just for a second, he doubled. And he fell down 600 feet down. Well, he survived. He only broke his left ankle, but the worst thing for him was the rescue that took 3 days. And he was dehydrated, no clothes, because he was just wearing short pants and a t-shirt. And the first day, nobody knew where was he. Everybody thought that he was probably in a disco or somewhere else. So the guide just reported to the policeman that he didn't sleep, and the police also told the tour guide that maybe somewhere, because people do that in the village. Yes. And finally, there was a dog that was barking in the little houses that we could see. No? Because this man was screaming at 10 in the morning, help me, help me, because he couldn't climb up here. And the dogs barking and barking, that the family finally decided to come out to see what was happening, and they saw him. So they had to walk along the railroad around this mountain to the police station, that they already were communicated that this man was lost. So they came, it was already 4 in the afternoon. When they saw him, it was 5 in the afternoon. So they called, hello, how are you? Help me, please. I need water, I need to be helped. We will come back tomorrow. It was already the second day. It rained the night that he spent in the cliff. And then the third day, a helicopter that was transporting also tourists to Machu Picchu was contracted to make the rescue. So the policeman came
no ropes, not no rescue equipment to come down, you know, with from the helicopter. So the helicopter had to come back to Cuzco, and policemen went to the fire station because the rescue team we have in Cuzco is in the fire station, okay, firefighters. And they said, we need that you lend your ropes and all your equipment, carabiners, aids, etc., etc. And they said, yeah, we can lend it to you, but one of us must go with you to check how the equipment is being used. Okay. And the policeman, no, we are going to use, you have to give us. So the commander came out. Oh. It was all a big problem that they were discussing for about 4 hours.
Oh, imagine this.
4 hours. And finally, at 2 p.m, policemen went to the fire station and they said, okay, we are going to take one of you. No, this time will be two. Oh, no, la, 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 la. Yeah, two of you, let's go. They came. It was 4 p.m. So the firefighters prepared all the equipment, throw the rope to rappel, you know, and they told to the policeman, okay, he's ready, go ahead. So the one of them, the bravest one, apparently, you know, went to the doorway of the helicopter. He looked down there, and he just, you are the professionals, you must go. So one of them jumped, and he picked this man up, and they got to the top of this mountain, you know, with the rope still flying, and they finally in the helicopter. And this is the story that he told me, because I talked to him, you know, and he told me about the spirits. So it's not something that I am just inventing or somebody.
California.
California.
Where
are we? All the crazy people are from.
But how could he not have been
injured? He went to the United States back. And he later returned to Peru after 2 months. And he said that he was having nightmares, he couldn't sleep. So he decided to come back again to Machu Picchu. And he lived in Peru for about a year. And after 6 years, when he was cured of this affrightment, he happened, you know, with spiritual man, you know. Finally, later he opened his tour agency in Aguascalientes, in the village. Mm-hmm. So he was selling tours also. We were joking that it was, you know, the spirit's jump or something like that.
contact with Brazilian Amazonia, stories have emerged from the jungle of a terrifying beast called the Mapinguari, a human-sized creature with long reddish fur. Its roar is said to sound like the last cries of dying human souls. Its smell alone is believed to cause disorientation and even death. For many, the Mapinguari is a mythical monster, a legend told to stop young children venturing into the forest. To others, including one American scientist, this monster is quite real.
The Amazon is full of animals that are unknown to science, plants too for that matter, or perhaps the plants or animals we don't know the life cycle very well or how large they get. The anaconda is one of those. We're not absolutely certain how large an anaconda can get. This plastic movie model anaconda is about the right size of an actual giant anaconda. Giant anacondas do get to weigh up to about 400 pounds. That makes them the heaviest snake on the planet. But anaconda, like a lot of reptiles, never really stop growing. And the result is we're not too sure precisely how big they can get. Now, the early explorers in the Amazon and in South America came to the conclusion that anacondas could be much larger. They reported many at 40, 50, 60 feet, much, much larger than we expect. Some of them had estimated anacondas at absolutely phenomenal lengths.
I'm 140 foot long. This is impossible. They don't get that big. However, once in a while, you come across a skin like this of such an anaconda that was shot by an explorer maybe 50 years ago. And this gives us a more accurate idea of just how big these snakes can become.
This skin is over 20 feet long and almost 3 feet wide. Now just imagine if I could find a snake this size, alive and well, in the wild.
There are two basic ways to get into Manu from Cuzco. Well, one is overland and the other one is by air. There is an airport at Boca Manu. Now this airport is particularly interesting. It has a kind of a checkered history. What you fly into now is an interesting little airstrip. But down at the end of the airstrip, about 100 meters past the flight line, there's a crashed airplane which was overloaded with cocaine years ago. Yes, this was originally a drug smuggling operation, and the military took it over, and the flights that go into and out of Boca Manu are still basically military flights. Incidentally, this is the airport terminal. This is where the radio control with the airplane is operated. All the luggage assembles here. This is the waiting area, and it's also the security checkpoint. There's a sign that specifically says that you're not allowed to bring hand grenades on board the airplane, among the usual things, of course. And of course, this is also the location of the gift shop. This has got to be the only airport gift shop where you can buy real bows and arrows. In any event, I didn't go in by air. Instead of using the airport facilities to arrive in the area, I went on overland. Basically, what we did was we went from Cuzco up over the mountains and into the cloud forest, and then down into the more tropical areas of Manu. The trip starts out in a bus,
going down a road which quickly becomes a dirt road and quickly becomes a one-lane road. Traffic alternates on this road every other day. One day the traffic will go from Cuzco down to Manu, and the next day the traffic will go up from Manu to Cuzco. The bad news is this is Sunday and traffic runs both ways. It sure looks to me like it's a good thing that I came in the dry season. Pretty soon you're going to see a picture of the road that we're on. And if you take a quick look at that land underneath the road, one of the things that you notice is that in some parts the road is starting to wash out. I'm pretty sure that in the rainy season this is a far more treacherous road. Now that we're off the high plateau, everything has changed. The area is greening up, there's considerably more water, there's considerably more vegetation, and there is considerably more wildlife. This is one of the better areas to see very colorful birds.
Look in the scope, man.
Now, every time that our bus had to cross some little ditch or stream or something like that, we discovered that this bus was not really high enough up off the ground, and they had to do all kinds of machinations to make sure that the back end wasn't torn out. And as a matter of fact, it was damaged during one of the operations. There was some body damage to it. They must have done this about a score of times from the time that we left Cuzco to the time that we got down to Manu. And not all of the operations were quite this complicated, but many of them were, and it slowed us down quite a bit. Our first morning in the cloud forest, we got up before dawn and went out to see the cock of the rock. Now, the cock of the rock is a bird that has very fanciful colorings, and its call is wonderful. The males here are trying to attract females at this lek. The next morning we boarded our boat, really a different kind of bus for a different kind of road, for the trip down to the Boca Manu area. Now, these waters do have piranha in them, and by reputation, you'd think what I'm about to do is somewhat foolhardy. But the fact of the matter is that these waters are apparently fairly safe. People do bathe in them, they swim in them, they splash around, and it doesn't seem to be a big problem. Our usual daily routine was to get up early in the morning and go out looking for wild animals, and then again in the evening. During the middle of the day, it was more typical for us to be either traveling, or perhaps, if we were lucky, we would get a break during the day when we could take a shower and perhaps a nap. Of course, it's in the evening when the animals really come out for viewing, and I'd like to call this little segment of the show the Small Game Hunt.
They're new roots.
Oh, really?
Remember
the
puna palm that I just pointed out to you earlier has these stilt roots.
Right.
Yeah, like some cylindrical shaped root system. The ceiba tree that we've just seen has buttress roots. Yeah? And this is the third root system that you would find in a tropical rainforest.
Crutches.
No, prop roots. Oh. They grow sort of out of the trunk and then bend down into the ground.
Like elephant noses, yes, yeah. And that's what this is going to be, huh? It looks mm-hmm. so flimsy.
Yeah.
Now, these are Aztec ants.
Yes.
And this is a cecropia?
Cecropia. Cecropia tree. These trees are fast-growing species, and this one probably stands in the middle of this forest here because there must have been a major disturbance. It means a tree fall or a palm fall. So there's a little patch of secondary growth here.
And the Aztec ants do?
The Aztec ants live inside the tree. Because the cecropia tree is all edible. Yeah, it has no chemical defense. So the ants live inside the tree, which is hollow, and they defend the tree against anything or anybody who would like to eat a piece of it. And in change, the ants get lodging.
These are the famous army ants. They're moving from one location to another. They don't have a
nest. Moving their eggs.
In the evening, they create what's called a bivouac, and their nest is made, constructed entirely of worker ants. Notice that they're carrying eggs along with them. And the larger ants that are there, with the large maniples, those are the soldier ants.
And when they bite, they will never ever open up their jaws again.
You can use them for sutures.
Exactly. That's exactly what some indigenous people do.
And what are the littler ones?
Workers.
They're just workers. Mm. They're carrying eggs and larvae.
And then they're going to get killed.
Oh, that's it. This is the kind of army ants that would, okay?
Yeah, you kind of want to invite them in.
The local folks like to invite army ants into their homes. The reason is because the army ants will pretty quickly clear out any other pests that you have, whether they're roaches or any other kind of insects. These are leafcutter ants. Leafcutter ants are farmers. They're taking those leaves back to the nest. Not to eat the leaves, or really to use them in construction, But those leaves are going to be masticated and turned into fertilizer for fungus, and it's the fungus that the ants eat.
This little guy's very confused. I get it's on the big leaf.
Have you ever been taught what they do with the leaf?
Sure.
Have you?
Take it back to your houses and...
Exactly. Take it back to your houses.
And they turn it into fungus.
And they cultivate. They chew it up first. Chew the leaves up. And they grow a fungus. And then they feed on that fungus. So they're farming ants.
Any particular leaf?
There are some leaves that they can't use because it'll kill the fungus.
Yeah.
So they have to be careful about the leaves.
There's a number of plants here that contains more or less antibiotics or antimycotics. So they have to be careful selecting their leaves, otherwise they kill their fungus growth.
Now there should be a small ant on the leaf.
Yes, not always though.
I know. Do you know what the small ant does?
It has a ride.
It has a ride, but it has a function.
What are you doing? Go ahead. What does it do?
Well, I'm asking, what's the function?
You know.
Of course.
Yeah, then you go ahead.
He's riding shotgun.
He's wearing the shotgun?
He's riding shotgun.
The small soldier ant depicted here is protecting the larger ant from a parasitic wasp.
The little tiny ones are supposed to... Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, these are different ones.
Yeah.
No, they're just crossing the ant road here. This is a crossroad.
So tiny things exist here.
But she didn't mention the soldier ants, and I think she's getting around to that now. Yes?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What you sometimes can see, the things that you can't see it here, I would like to show it. Anyway, there are these tiny ants that are also leafcutter ants, but that are soldiers. Among leafcutter ants, the soldier ants are bigger than the workers, which is not the case with army ants, but here it is. And sometimes you would find those small soldier ants having a ride on top of a leaf that a worker is carrying. Now, the question is, why would a...
Now, these are bullet ants. They're very large ants, an inch or sometimes closer to 2 inches in length, and very heavy. And they have the world's most powerful sting. The sting may last for 16 to 24 hours and cause severe pain and swelling. The bullet ants are followed by a collection of walking sticks, by a wolf spider, and by a poison dart frog. And finally, we have a large, fresh jaguar footprint, probably from maybe the night before. White-lipped peccary run in herds of 100 or 200, and they can be quite dangerous. They have been known to kill and eat people.
I'm just going to wait a second to see if they come close.
White-lipped peccary are basically small hogs or wild boar, if you will. Although they're dangerous in large numbers, and we hear some up ahead, it turns out to be just a small herd. Here the woolly monkey is demonstrating his prehensile tail. This tail can grab hold of branches and support the monkey. Old world monkeys cannot do this. The noise you hear is the woolly monkeys throwing sticks at us to try to drive us out of their jungle. The woolly monkeys made quite a demonstration against us. They threw sticks at us. In fact, I was hit by a stick, and one of the branches that they threw down on us was 8 or 9 feet in length. It made a tremendous crash when it hit the ground. Eventually, the woolly monkeys drove us off, and I'm sure that they went immediately to the local bar and started swapping stories about how those huge monkey-eating primates were driven off. Nobody really knows why these birds come to this clay lick, but it probably acts as something of an antacid or a stomach ease of some kind. They've probably been eating things with defensive chemicals in them that are upsetting the bird's stomach, and this clay seems to settle it out. There is another reason for the birds to be here, and the macaws in particular. They mate for life, and they use these clay licks as kind of a meeting place, a cotillion, if you will. If you see three macaws together, usually what that means is that the third one is the baby who has not yet selected a life partner. Incidentally, this next scene shows the blind that we used to photograph the birds. It used to be a boat on an oxbow lake. The oxbow lake has dried up, and the boat is now stranded and not able to move around, but it still provides good cover. This bird show continued for quite a while. Then all of a sudden, about halfway through the morning, the birds exploded out of the trees and headed for who knows where. Only a few seconds later, it became obvious to us exactly why that was. There appeared in one of the trees a crested eagle, and that apparently was what the macaws saw that decided the issue for them. The appearance of the eagle basically put an end to the macaw show. Manu is a very interesting place. It's about the size of Massachusetts, and there are some Indians in Manu that are not known to science and have not been formally contacted. In addition, back in 1987, the president of Peru was visiting Manu, and he was met by a shower of arrows. Now, all of the natives that I ran into, at least, were much more friendly than that. Thank you.
Which snake is he? Dunturus? Oh, no.
He is a rat snake.
On caterpillars or on butterflies of this area, and even less about which caterpillar belongs to which butterfly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, near, virtually impossible for me to find out. That's why there's so much stuff I don't know. Something that's interesting is that very often these are caterpillars of the same species.
This is a tapir clay lick that we're going to be going to, and we're looking for tapir. We don't find them. The tapir eluded us. They're the largest mammal in this area of the Amazon. One of the things that you're going to be noticing is that we're going to be laying down under mosquito netting. After this event was over, the guide told us that there was more than one reason for that mosquito netting. It turns out that this area has vampire bats. In addition to vampire bats, there were also some fishing bats. There was a small creek out in front of us, and they were seeing if they could catch some fish out there. These are long-nosed bats that we came across during the daylight. Long-nosed bats are apparently pretty common. In fact, bats are pretty common. 40% of all mammals in the Amazon are bats. In addition to traveling on the river in a motorboat, we also had a sort of a catamaran that we took around some oxbow lakes. Basically, it was a raft on two dugouts, and there were two guys in behind the raft that paddled along so that we weren't making any substantial amount of noise. And we saw some of our most interesting close-up views of animal life from those rafts.
Take one of those.
but in Cuzco.
These are side-neck turtles. They can't pull their heads directly back into their shell. They kind of have to tuck them into the side. The butterflies that are there are trying to collect extra minerals out of the nostrils or eyes of the turtles. One of the strangest birds has got to be the Watson. It differs so much from all other birds that kinship is kind of doubtful. It may be related to game birds, it may be related to the cuckoo, it may be related to the chicken. Although it's got wings, frankly, it prefers to creep along the branches rather than fly. It doesn't seem to like to fly at all, and flight from tree to tree is slow and kind of labored. The adult's about the size of a mourning dove. It uses its wings more like arms climbing around the trees, and when it's young, it actually has claws at what would be the wrist that would allow the young to climb around the limbs a little bit easier, perhaps. In addition, it eats mangrove leaves, and the result is that its gullet is 50 times larger than its stomach. It feeds on the fruit and leaves of other trees as well that grow along the riverbank. Now, the local folks say that this bird is not good eating. They call it the stinking pheasant. The locals do use this bird, however, for arrow flight feathers. We're moving now away from the Watson to another oxbow lake denizen. This is the giant otter. The giant otter is probably, as much as anything else, a primary reason why I came to Manu. They're extremely rare these days, and in this area they are about as common as they are any place on the face of the planet. Here we see them eating their usual lunch. They eat fish, and they eat large quantities of it. As a matter of fact, a giant otter may eat as much as 3 tons of fish over the course of a year. Now, the result of that is that they're not particularly popular with local fishermen. And between 1950 and 1970, giant otter pelts were very popular. And between those years, 1950 and 1970, Peru alone exported 20,000 giant otter pelts. And so the population of otters was greatly reduced, and seen as though these do not give birth to large numbers of young, they've had some difficulty reconstituting their original numbers. In fact, they'll probably never do that. Giant otters generally get up to be 4 or 5 feet long. Record size put them at 8 feet. Which would be quite large, of course. Otters are carnivores, technically. They eat primarily fish, in fact, almost exclusively fish. But in a group, they are aggressive enough to be able to defend themselves from things like a jaguar, which is the third largest cat in the world, only behind the lion in weight. Pumas and anacondas. Now this, of course, depends on them being in a group. If they're alone, they're far more vulnerable, of course. You've just seen what male otters do for a living. We had gotten a little bit too close to the pod here, and the result was that the male otters came off to tell us that we were a little too close and we needed to back off. Here we see a baby crawling up on a tree limb, and that's probably one of the reasons why the male otters were so aggressive. On the other hand, male otters do the least amount of fishing of all of the otters, but they eat the most amount of fish. I often tell folks that otters eat piranha for lunch, and in fact they do. The otters will eat just about any kind of fish for as far as that goes, but piranha does make up a substantial portion of their diet. I spent a lot of time watching these otters. After all, it was the primary reason I was down at Manu. But one of the things that I noticed was that the baby otter there is getting absolutely no peace. Every time it tries to take a rest, and it's apparently very tired, one of its siblings, or one of the adults at least, will come along and pull it off the tree, or push it off the branch. It just doesn't seem to be able to get any rest at all. Giant otters are just like any other kind of otters anywhere. They're extremely playful. And I figure that the adults just want the baby to get in the water so that they can play together. It also looks like the baby otter is using the tree as some kind of a teething ring. It looks like it's working its mouth a little bit on that tree to try to do something, either sharpen the teeth or cut them through gums or something. I think that maybe this giant otter is mom and that she's checking on the kid to see if he's okay.
Thank you.
Well, that pretty much ends the otter show. One of the things that I learned, or one of the collection of things that I learned that I really hadn't expected, was that the guide really knew quite a bit about the vegetation in the area and what the local people were using it for. And so we're going to be leaving this Oxbow Lake, and we're going to be going back through the forest, and we're going to take a look at a certain amount of vegetation and see how it's used and what it's good for.
What the hell?
There's nothing to do. Smell, you haven't smelled yet.
Is that bug?
It's just a tiny little bit of bug. Oh. Do they use that in cooking?
No.
Nope. No.
What is it?
You can smell it, right?
Oh yeah, I got it.
Yeah. Has nothing to do with the regatta you use for cooking. But it is a very nice example of a tree that tries to defend itself against being eaten up too much by being untasty. It's going quite well.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Correct?
And it keeps what away? What kind of things does it keep away?
Mosquito. Well, no. It's also a useful tree for local people, because the garlic tree, the garlic smell, keeps away all sorts of potentially nasty critters, like scorpions, spiders, snakes. So if you have to spend a night in the jungle for some reason, you're well advised to look for a garlic tree. So you can sleep at its base and you're totally safe.
Fish.
Except you can't see. Figs are edible. We've got tons of different figs. This grows from a fig seed, from a tiny, tiny seed. So as figs are edible, they're eaten by monkeys or by birds. So those tiny seeds go through the animal, insect. They end up somewhere up in the canopy, on a tree or on a palm tree. Surrounding fig germinates, starts to grow, sends down roots, and wherever the roots come together, they fuse, they grow together, and involve the whole string, or the whole palm tree. So over the time, the strangler fig does not allow the whole tree to grow anymore. It competes the whole tree out, and it ends up being an independent tree. The whole tree inside dies, and gets eaten up by grubs and termites. So the strangler fig replaces other trees in that way, and you get the most bizarre root structures. Now this strangler fig is already fully grown, but until 3 years ago you could still see the dead trunk of the whole tree in the middle. Now it's eaten up, it has been eaten up.
How many years?
Well, as I say, 3 years ago there still was a piece of whole trunk.
Yes, older.
How old is it? This one? Roughly, very roughly, altogether maybe 50. The size of the strangler fig always depends on the size of the host tree and on where it has started to grow. Now, one of the questions of your final exam on Monday will be, why have strangler fig not taken over yet?
In the Amazon, the roots of trees tend to spread out a great deal more than they do in many other places. They don't tend to go very deep into the earth, but instead to spread along the surface, because that's where most of the nutrients are. We've got one of the tour group here posing so that you can get some idea how large this particular tree is. The next scene is also a very interesting tree. This is called the walking palm, and the walking palm actually has the ability to move its position by a few feet one way or the other. In addition, the walking palm has some very large spikes on the on it, and those large spikes are believed to have been put there in order to ward off the now extinct giant ground sloth from attacking it. And now one of the real highlights of the trip up into the canopy. This is a 100-foot tower that you're looking at. We're going to climb up that tower and get up into the top of one of the really big trees and take a look around. From up here in the top of the canopy, you really do feel like you're Tarzan. You ought to be able to grab a grapevine or something and swing over to the next tree. It's great to be able to see the top of the jungle the same way that many of the monkeys and birds do.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the king of the jungle.
Flying through the foliage, surveying the scenery, cruising in for a closer look, and swinging on through the trees with effortless ease.
George not feels so good.
This little mother is kind of special, and I say mother because in a few minutes you're going to be able to see the baby. It's clinging to her underside. Not only will you see the baby and the baby's face, but it will be suckling.
Baby and mom. This, would you like to have a look at this? I mean, this is really cute. Just goes and her breast. Because up in the canopy, well, first of all, in the canopy it's too hot. Second, brown capuchins use both the lower levels of the forest and the high canopy. But it's a clearer shade now, because it's not so hot. And they obviously find some in the middle of it. Brown capuchins eat the high canopy. They're the ones to the left. That's a baby.
The open branch?
Yeah, yeah, that's a baby.
He actually looks like a baby.
This is a baby.
I mean, like a human baby.
Yeah. Can I try to put me in the scope?
Yeah.
It's chewy. It's chewy.
I know.
It's probably our... Yeah. Look at this little guy. Oops. Many monkeys are hungry at this time of the year because there's not much food.
These are red howler monkeys. They can be heard 1 or 2 miles away pretty easily. As a matter of fact, a howling group of these monkeys can be louder than the roar of a lion, and it's said that these howling monkeys produce more noise than any other terrestrial animal. The body is a big, thick body, and it gets to be about 27 inches long, including the tail. And they travel in groups of 4 to maybe 35 or so. They are able to make those loud noises because of an enlarged hyoid bone, an enlarged larynx. You'll see that the neck is very thick. Some of these red howlers are mothers, and you can see the baby hanging to the belly or sometimes on the back. Howlers usually do their howling at dawn, or maybe in the evening, or in advance of a rain. They sound something like this.
Thank you.
harpy eagles.
Oh.
The harpy eagles are huge, massive eagles that specialize on sloths and halibuts.
Oh. Is there an immature bird there? This one that's on the very tip of this. He's so creamy.
Well, it's about time to stop monkeying around and leave the friendly denizens of the Amazon and get back to our plane.
Even monkeys here know why people come.
Yeah.
They're conscious
monkeys. They take solace as well.
Come on, show a little backbone, will ya?